Hello, everybody. Thank you all for coming out. This is a really joyous occasion for me to be able to introduce San Luis Obispo and the broader community of Central Coast California to the artist Cobi Moules, and to celebrate his solo exhibition at the Harold J. Miossi Art Gallery, Showering Sparkling Bits. My name is Tim Stark. I am the curator of the Harold J. Miossi Art Gallery at Cuesta College. When I approached Cobi about doing an exhibition with the gallery, it was with the specific intent of bringing in an important voice within our contemporary art culture that was speaking towards a queer identity and a uniquely queer identity with a technically masterful hand and with a intellectually challenging perspective. And Cobi graciously accepted, and on top of that said, I'll do you one better, I want to make an entirely new body of work with an entirely new material that I've never worked with before, but I'm gonna branch out because I think it's important. And so we partnered together to be able to produce this excellent and progressive show that is up in the Harold J. Miossi Art Gallery right now through the middle of March. Showering Sparkling Bits displays a broad range of reimaginings of the early American landscape painters from the Hudson River School and reinterprets and repositions the queer body as the central focus of those paintings. Cobi Moules received his BFA
from San Jose State University in 2004, and then went to Tufts University and School of Museum of Fine Arts to receive his MFA. His work has been collected in too many institutions for me to list right now. But some of the most important ones are the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston, Crystal Bridges Museum. He received the SMFA Traveling Fellowship and the Harold Kevin Foundation grant, the Joan Mitchell MFA grant, along with many others. His work is important and valuable and speaks to a truth that we desperately need to hear within our country right now. So without further ado, Cobi Moules.
Is it working? Okay, good. Thank you so much, Tim. That was very generous. And it's just been so wonderful to be able to make this work and have the support that you and the gallery have really helped to really make this happen. And I just feel very honored to be here, and thank you all for coming. It's been really wonderful. So with the talk, I'm going to talk about two projects. First, I'm going to talk about an earlier one called Boys Just Want to Have Fun, and that small painting with the multiple figures is a representation of that project. And then, of course, Showering of Sparkling Bits, which you've seen in the gallery. So both of these projects really focus on landscape and the queer body in nature. So really thinking about how the queer body is represented and how it's engaging with the landscape, and particularly the American landscape. And so starting with the Boys Just Want to Have Fun, this is a larger piece, 40 by 70 inches, and it's called Fog Off of Mount Desert Island. And this is a project where I've multiplied myself throughout the Grand American landscape, specifically locations that the Hudson River School worked from. And so just to give you a very brief overview of the Hudson River School, they are a group of landscape painters in the mid-1800s. They were based in New York. Many of them had studios in New York City. They had homes along the Hudson River. They're not a natural school, in case you didn't know. and many don't know. But they're a group of painters, really the first European American painters that saw the American wilderness as this important subject matter. They viewed it as something that really set America apart. And really kind of focusing on the wilderness was a way of creating an identity that was based around kind of American exceptionalism. And I'll get more into kind of conceptually their work later in into the talk. But early on, their subject matter was really based in New York and New England. So you have the Catskills and the Adirondacks, Niagara Falls, all in New York, and then you also have the White Mountains in New Hampshire, as well as like the coast of Maine, and a bunch of other areas, but those are kind of the main locations in the early years. And then also like second generation of the Hudson River School painters, like Albert Bierstadt and Thomas Moran, took these big trips out west and painted scenes from Yellowstone and Yosemite, the Grand Canyon. And so this was really this art movement that lasted from around the 1820s to the 1870s. They worked throughout the states and a bit in South America, but largely was located on that northeast and the west. And so with this painting, Fog Off Mount Desert Island, it's referencing this Frederick Church painting on the left of the same name. And so here I really wanted to go into this general landscape of Mount Desert Island, which is located in Maine, also Acadia National Park, so maybe some of you have been there. And I wanted to kind of place myself on the coast of that general location and really capture this kind of storm that is rolling in. So it's not the exact location, but it's more of like the general area. And so here's a painting of Lake George in New York. And I'm going to use this piece as to show my process. So I tend to work in the same area a number of times. With Lake George, I ended up taking a couple separate trips to the same location. And so here's a map of the area. Lake George is in New York, it's near Albany. And so what I do is I'll spend about a week or so in one area, camping, hiking, just really exploring the place, kind of finding these spots that I was excited to work in. And so that red line shows the area that I spent most of my time in during this trip. And so the way I work is I'll set up my camera, and with a wireless shutter release, I'm able to really photograph myself running around, playing, swimming, doing all sorts of stuff, and have this freedom of play without worrying about what I'm actually capturing. So in each kind of day, I'll take hundreds of photographs, just kind of imagining these different interactions happening in the space. And then I bring those back into the studio, compile them together to create one really large image that I'll then use to create the painting. So here it's just a small section of one much larger image that I created to make this piece. And so you can see that island kind of in the middle right there, although it's flipped. So, and this is the largest piece I did. It's a 57 by 86 inch painting. And so here are three Kinza paintings of Lake George, and then also a couple of detail shots on the bottom right. And there are these recurring elements in paintings of Lake George from the Hudson River School. You have these mountains in the background, you have an island or two, and then there's also this kind of rock shoreline, sometimes with some trees. And then in the detail shots, you can see that two of the paintings have this person, really tiny person, rowing a canoe way in the back, really small, what is in shadow, barely even visible. And so these figures are really intentionally shrunk down to give the landscape a much more grand presence to them. So with this piece, I'm pulling in all of those same elements, the mountains, the islands, this rocky shore, but instead of having this tiny solitary figure kind of timidly rowing by, I'm really overwhelming the space with around 80 to 90 figures of me engaging in a much more active and pronounced way. So really the focal point kind of and the weight of the painting shifts to this community. And so here's a Thomas Graham painting of Yellowstone. And what I'm struck by and am responding to within their work is their relationship between God, nature, and the individual. Oftentimes there won't be figures at all in their work, but when there are, like in this one and like with the late George, they're extremely tiny and really shrunken down. Here, they're kind of far back, right on the edge of this cliff, kind of looking out at this canyon. And so really just kind of tiny, almost ant-like. And so there's this idea within these paintings of the insignificance of the individual and really the grand kind of manifestation of God within the American landscape. And so that piece is a 7-foot by 12-foot painting. So you can get a real sense of kind of the monumentality of its scale. And what becomes really important in conveying that grandeur and that kind of magnificence of God is not only that figure to landscape scale difference, but also that painting to viewer relationship as well. And so when I think of myself kind of standing in front of this painting and imagining myself in it, there is this limitation to how I'm able to engage within the space, whether that be envisioning myself as one of these little people right on that edge and being diminished within it, or this inability to enter into it altogether. So there's so much beauty in these paintings, but there's also this real inherent danger as well. That rock right on the front, it feels so inviting, like you could just step out onto it. But if you did, this wave would just come and pull you out into the sea. Here's a Frederick Church painting. Again, it's called Heart of the Andes, and it's a 6-foot by 10-foot painting. And so oftentimes their paintings will contain some form of water, whether that's a lake or a waterfall. And then there'll be sometimes light beaming through the clouds. And these are meant to kind of represent these moments of purity and virginity within these wilderness spaces. And so artists like Church and Moran and other Hudson River School painters, they would often talk about how the landscape was this representation of God, this kind of new kind of innocence of Eden, in a way. And again, you see this drastic detail shot of that painting, and you see the drastic scale difference, even more extreme than this painting, with these two little figures next to this cross, which again is this overt symbol of worship. And so one thing I found really fascinating with these artists is they really viewed their role as a kind of priest, kind of assisting folks towards the divinity. And this landscape acted as this kind of natural Bible, that they were there to then read, interpret, and then enlighten folks through this Christian moral lens. And so the vast majority of their work was in North America, but Church, with this piece, he did a lot of work in South America as well, so he went down and did a number of pieces there. And so I see a lot of parallels within their work and ideologies that were really integral to my conservative Christian upbringing. So ideas around purity and virginity, as well as this emphasis on sacrifice. So there was this really importance and honor of sacrificing oneself for God. And this feels especially pertinent being queer and being trans, that through that very specific Christian lens, I'm told that I must suppress who I am in order to fulfill certain moral obligations. And that who I am is unnatural, it's going against God. So all of these kind of ideas coming at me. And really the use of nature, whether that's through language or imagery, has been used to create this kind of moral authority that can be really overwhelming. And it can be a very powerful tool for control and conformity. And so with this body of work, I'm really interested in kind of renegotiating my relationship with all of these ideas and shifting the weight within these spaces, kind of redefining and altering how my queer body and self relate to the landscape and all of the baggage that it carries. So really creating kind of this community that's full of excitement, it's full of self-worth and play. So there's really kind of a freedom of self within this work. Kind of exploring nature, exploring myself within it, and then also being a part of it. And so some of the scenes have a more kind of excited, exuberant feeling, rolling around, energetically engaging with each other, whether that be in a more innocent playground type of feel, like you see in this piece, or one that hints at more of a kind of a bodily and sexual exploration. So here I have bodies intertwining, rubbing themselves up against the rocks, rubbing themselves up against each other, and then others just kind of lounging around, watching things happen. And so each location really brings out kind of these different scenes. This particular spot was very chilly and foggy. A big storm had just taken place. And there was these incredibly loud crashing waves, and it's just this perfect spot to just kind of sit, watch, and be much more kind of calm and meditative. And then we're here, the sun was out, these fall colors were super intense, and also having these different levels of rocks kind of created this perfect stage to play on. So it really created this very exciting playground type of environment to work in. And here it's much more calm and silent. You have these little rocks kind of peeking out of this really still water, and it was really beautiful and serene, but it was also a little eerie and lonesome at the same time. So along with these solitary figures, it really needed this more kind of intimate coupling on that bottom right to really balance that out. And so some of the locations are very specific and direct. Like this painting is located in Catterskill Falls in the Catskill Mountains. So I was able to find that specific spot and work in it, and it was really wonderful. That's not always the case. And here, Catterskill Clove, also in the Catskill Mountains, this piece on the right is based on these two pieces, one by Duran and one by Gifford. So it's the same location, but it's just a slightly different staging. And with this is much more general. This is a painting of the Adirondacks by Thomas Cole on the left, and then my painting is in the White Mountains. So different states even. But the importance here became this kind of fall-covered mountains, this high up vantage point, and really trying to kind of capture the essence of the space rather than a specific location. And so I was thinking a lot about not only transforming these landscapes through the use of the figures, but also thinking about the scale of the paintings themselves, as well as the size of the spaces that I'm depicting. So this is Amoran painting that's 12 feet wide. It's sitting on the rim, or maybe just a bit below it, and you're looking out at this really massive space, this really dramatic view, and I really wanted to shrink that down. So rather than being on the rim, I hiked it down to the bottom where it becomes much smaller and much more intimate. So you have this 12-foot painting versus this like 20-inch painting. And the sizes really of this body of work really vary quite a bit. They range from as small as 6 by 8 inches, which was on the first slide, that tiny little painting, that was a 6 by 8. And then the Lake George being 57 by 86. So with the Grand Canyon, I'm taking something really monumental and shrinking it down. And in here, I'm taking something really small and kind of far in the distance and bringing it forward and really scaling it up. This little painting on the left is a Frederick Church painting called Scudic Peninsula from Mount Desert Island at Sunset. It's only a 9 by 14 inch painting, so it's really small. And his vantage point is on the main island, and he's kind of looking out at the peninsula. It's really small, it's dark, and it's far out. So I was really curious about kind of what could be happening out there, what the scene would look like. And so that's what this piece is doing. So it's located on the peninsula. I went over to that other side. It's a much lighter time of day, and then the scale is much larger. It's a 45 by 80. So all of these different ways, just kind of ways of highlighting the scene that could be taking place out on his little tiny painting. And here's a detailed shot. And so I wanted the figures to, at times, almost blend in with the rocks. So the color of the jacket and the hat, kind of mimicking this orange mossy type of substance that's all over the rocks. But then at the same time, when it's up against the water, really kind of stand out. So there's this kind of push and pull between the figure and its surroundings. And so here's the reference again for that piece. And while I was working on that piece, I started to think a lot about how I'm using the references and how the queer body really kind of sits within the frame. So, I really wanted to push both of those elements. So, rather than going into the actual landscapes like I was doing with The Boys Just Want to Have Fun, I decided to paint their original landscape and use that as a backdrop for the figures. And with the bodies, I really wanted them to be much more visibly queer. I wanted to show the chest stars. I had them wearing these wonderful jockstraps, which is this just beautiful piece of clothing that is, you know, it's very common in queer fashion. it's very revealing, and I feel like it's such a special object, especially on a trans body. Because it's very revealing, it's the celebration of the trans body as beautiful and different. So this piece that I did called Finding Pleasures in the Cracks is one of the few pieces that were kind of the beginning of, and kind of transitional images into the work that you've seen in the gallery. And so also with this work, rather than viewing this kind of full scenes of folks running around, I'm blowing them up to this really large scale. So to the point that you can't really see the full picture. So rather than overwhelming the space, thinking about kind of obscuring them. And so when I was working on The Boys Just Want to Have Fun, I would often get so many images of me really close to the camera, blurry, and just tons of throwaway images. But as I was thinking about this project, I started thinking about those images as much more interesting. And so by pushing the scale, especially with this piece, I really wanted these kind of intertwining bodies to the point where you're not really sure what's happening immediately, or it's not immediately recognizable that there are two figures and whose legs are what? Are they legs? So, and like, eventually, I think you get it, but immediately, it's not necessarily recognizable. And I also started to work with these different materials. Glitter, silicone, some hair. I added glitter to the jockstraps. There's some between the cracks, along the chest scars, the nipples, all these really lovely sensitive bits. And so you can see the different materials that I'm beginning to play with in this first image. And so the silicone really started as more of a framing element, kind of thinking about how the frame is related to the body in the paintings. This piece is called Enjoying the Views from Donner Lake. And so the reference image is just a section and a more of a blurred out section of that painting. And so I wanted this frame to kind of have this similar softness to the skin and these like repeated freckles and age spots, in a way kind of pooling the painting outside of itself. Kind of see the texture of the material. I want it to be very squishy and malleable and have this really strange and wonderful feeling to it. And so at this point, like I was saying, it's really confined as a frame to the kind of the outer edge. But I also then started to kind of think about and experiment with how this material could really begin to move beyond that. So this is a very tiny moment where the frame opens up and you can see the sunset visible through this hole and the figure's kind of looking down at or through this moment where it begins to open up. So those three paintings are kind of this transition into this work, and you'll see this piece in the gallery. And here the silicone is still confined to as a frame, but in a very different way. So here I'm using it to wrap around the painting, giving the painting its own jockstrap in a way. And so here I also decided to remove the figures altogether and just leave behind this glittery jockstrap. And in this case, there's only one tiny one kind of on the bottom left rock, just kind of draped over this rock. And the scale of the jockstraps is the same as the boys just want to have fun. So I kind of, in the beginning, imagined these as remnants of this queer gathering that these boys from the Boys Just Want to Have Fun kind of left this little surprise for us. And here's a detailed image so you can see the one little jockstrap. And so with the frame, I'm using this light yellow and this glitter in the frame as a way to kind of mimic this jockstrap in the painting. And also the texture is it's more kind of a smooth, firmer texture. It has a lot more structure to it than the previous ones. And so I was kind of thinking about how the jockstrap forms and supports the body. And I really wanted the framing in this piece to do something very similar. And so again, I'm copying the original, but I wanted it to be much lighter and brighter, kind of giving it more of a different feel to the environment, something much more welcoming. And here's another example, but there's a lot more jockstraps kind of laying around and hanging from the trees. And with these specific pieces, with the yellow framing, I did quite a few of them. And the composition tends to, I want a very specific type of composition within these particular paintings. I want this very kind of small enclosed spaces here kind of created by these trees. And then with this opening of like a sky or a really distant landscape in the back, it's almost kind of creates this like enclosed kind of church-like composition. And here the stuff, silicone, goes in a completely different direction. And it really starts to take on a very different form. I think about it as a figure, kind of this amorphous body that is moving over the paintings. And again, here the texture goes back to that really squishy, fun material. And so I'm thinking about this body as this kind of fluid, non-gendered queer body, lacking from structure, but still having bodily specificity. So here's a detail shot. You can see these kind of pink, glittery moles. This one also has a single jockstrap, that tiny little hole that's just kind of just a little opening up from this big mass with just one little jockstrap peeking through. And so I'm thinking a lot about kind of a, both a covering up and an obscuring of the original paintings, but also a revealing of these new scenes with these remnants. And so one way I think about this kind of unseen gathering is similar to the boys, just a bunch of tiny figures running around and having a great time leaving these remnants. But then I also kind of imagine, and I started imagining this a little bit later on as the project kind of got further in, but as this blob, as both a single mass, but also this conjoined mass of many smaller blobs. And so perhaps these figures, these blob figures, are the bodies that left these jock straps behind. And then maybe they're coming together to create this mass as they're leaving. And I feel like that's something that I find really exciting with this material and with this work, is kind of the ambiguity of what could be happening or what did happen. So yeah, I'm really excited. Like the interpretation, like there's so much openness that could be taking place within this work. And so one of the main references to the silicone body are these blob figures in 1980s war films. The most notably is the movie The Blob, which was in 1988. And I'm going to show you a few clips. It's really kind of roughly cut together, so I do apologize for that. But it'll kind of give you an arc of the movie a bit. And just to briefly say, it's the blob in this movie is this kind of alien creature that comes crashing into this really small, quaint town and threatens its peaceful existence. So we're going to go ahead and watch just a short little clip.
Yeah.
It's much better in its entirety, but those are kind of the best moments. Oops, don't worry about that again. So it's this one-track minded creature that is basically to consume everyone it can. Even folks that would typically be safe main characters in other horror films, like the popular jock and the motherly figure, and even children, they get eaten, which is wild. And so this monster really leans into this soul desire to consume bodies. And as it consumes, it continues to grow. So you can see the two images, this tiny little thing into this gigantic blob that's the size of this car. And so in the 1980s, which is when I was growing up, it was filled with this overwhelming sense of panic that was expressed through horror films of the time. There were so many movies during this period with creatures that were either trying to consume you or enter your body and take it over. We had the Satanic Panic, we had the Gay Panic, and the AIDS epidemic, and all of these fears were really tied together and played out in these movies. And so many of these monsters were metaphors for queers that were coming to destroy this traditional life and infect your neighborhoods and take your children. And the blob is probably the most famous of the blob monsters, but there are quite a few during this time. These are a couple stills from the movie The Stuff that was made in 1985. And I'm going to play you the trailer for this movie because it's amazing. And that's why. Perpetuates fear and degradation. And the imagery is in both of them is very foundational. So the landscape being a huge influence on kind of the structure and the ideas of America. And the films, they were both kind of this influence on and a reflection of the ideas towards queer people during the 80s and on. And so a lot of these ideas that come from the landscape and come from the films, they really continue to live on. They don't just kind of abruptly stop, the 80s are over, all is good. They really have a lot of influence on kind of where we are today, kind of each generation inherits these ideas and these fears from the previous one. And so with this body of work, I'm kind of, compared to The Boys Just Want to Have Fun, I'm moving away from the personal narrative and me as a central figure. I'm beginning to think beyond the threads that really tie into my own upbringing. That's also there, and it's all really important in my thinking, but it's a lot less direct. So I'm thinking much more about kind of how these landscapes have informed a much larger cultural identity, and how they've really helped push a very kind of flawed and destructive moralistic culture. And so I'm really interested in and focusing on how these ideas have been kind of perpetuated through these paintings and how they've really carried this enormous weight into the present day. And not only do I see that reflected in my own upbringing, but also it's very central to this mainstream kind of conservative rights hold socially and politically that we're seeing kind of playing out today. All this rhetoric around kind of moralistic obligations that at least partially stems from the work that these artists were doing. It's very seductive in its beauty, but it really pushes a lot of harmful ideas around purity and around race and around belonging. And one of their purposes was to kind of help push manifest destiny. And growing up, my memory of being taught about manifest destiny in grade school was something that was really exciting and admirable. It was this wonderful feat that happened, which is wild, and I'm hoping that that's changed, but I don't know for sure. But it's really this belief that the white conservative Christian conquest was this endowment by God and this moral obligation. There was this entitlement within that, and the way that they used religion and the landscape as this tool for control and for the elimination of what they deemed as ungodly. And so that's a lot of the background. It's a lot of pretty heavy stuff. But this is all the stuff that I'm thinking about, and it's really important, I think, to reflect on. And with this work, I'm really trying to kind of make sense of and find all the places where all of this mess kind of connects. And so I'm doing that in a way that really examines these formative works, and while also rendering these kind of new views of this landscape that's really full of queer joy. So I'm utilizing these images that have this kind of underlying push for control and having this amorphous body over and around these paintings and these jockstraps and glitter sprinkled about. And so here's a close-up so you can get a sense of that squishy texture. And just to see how I'm using these materials of the silicone and the glitter as a way to kind of alter and queer this space. And similar to The Boys, I do see like a sense of freedom and autonomy within these bodies, but here it's specifically coming from this kind of fluidity and the way that it moves across the paintings. And then sometimes the paintings are completely covered up, and there's a lot more subtlety within this piece, for instance. There's kind of a question of what's the painting that I'm seeing and what's part of the blob. They kind of merge together. And here there's just a small section of these trees kind of peeking out from the opening. And the body's starting to kind of come off the panels and onto the wall. The colors are starting to change. They really span between kind of the natural skin tones as well as these kind of alien-like skin tones as well. And so the coloration and the texture, it really sometimes kind of mimics the landscape. So I think of these two elements, the landscape and the body, as really informing one another. So here, The color's a little off, so it's a little harder to tell, but the body is mimicking the texture and the color of the sky, but then it's also kind of moving across and altering the landscape. At least that's kind of how I'm thinking about it. And here's a detailed shot. So you can see like this figure removed and replaced with a jockstrap. And then the variation in the silicone colors. And then there's also glitter all around the jockstraps. I'm kind of thinking about them as if they're sprinkling a little magic around. And so here's a piece where I did something a little differently. The landscape starts to, you know, become more abstract, where this body is really kind of squeezing the painting into itself. So I have all these different kind of avenues of exploration, how the silicone is relating to the painting. And so there are other blob-like alien figures in pop culture earlier than the 80s that I also think about as well. They're less in the forefront, but they kind of get stuck in my head and I can't stop thinking about them. And this is the flying parasite in the original Star Trek that was in 1967. So I'm just going to show you a little clip from that. Center, kind of similar to the way that it just kind of grabs onto Spock's back. And here I'm using this really beautiful, like, green alien color. And you can see the hairs kind of coming out the bottom. And here's another one where I was, again, thinking about that same kind of plopping action. And so the last thing I just want to quickly talk about is kind of the way I see these kind of functioning together. And so I took a few snapshots of the exhibition. They're not the best images, but hopefully they'll do. Just to kind of give you a sense of the space, which many of you have already seen the show, so you know what's there. And so as I was beginning this work, each piece kind of really started out as very singular and contained. And then as the project got further in, the bodies really started to move off the panels more and more. And I wanted the work and the space to have this feeling of movement, as if this kind of body is seeping from the corners of the gallery, kind of pulling maybe some of the work off the wall and taking them away. I kind of think of this piece as if it's kind of heading for the door. And I also really wanted the viewer to be able to experience this weird and wonderful kind of tactile flesh-like body. And I wanted to create a way that you could experience that without like touching the paintings, because I have this, like, I want people to touch them, but I don't want them to touch them. And so I wanted to find some way to like make it happen. So I decided to create this bench. And since there's no painting in it, it's very durable. So you're able to sit on it. It's the one interactive piece in the show. So you can sit, push your hands into it, give it a squeeze. It can evoke a kind of such a visceral reaction. Sometimes people are creeped out or grossed out by it, which I'm okay with. but it also can evoke a real exciting and kind of pleasurable feeling, which is kind of where I'm coming from. And so when you're in the gallery, I really encourage you to just kind of take a moment and like just sit on it, enjoy it while you're looking at all of these little paintings. And so that's where I'm gonna leave it. Oh yeah, any questions? Yeah.
I might have missed it talking to you the other day, but how long have you been working with the silicone then? Until when did you kind of start?
It's right when I was talking with Tim, like 2 years ago, is when it really began. Like I had these ideas, but they were just kind of percolating. And then I probably did maybe 3 to 6 months of that 2 year period of more of like research. And then, so about a year and a half of like solidly working on with the material.
Yeah. It's so fun.
Yeah. Did you have the ideas for the imagery in the series before you thought about the silicone, or was it more like you found the silicone more attractive and then the imagery kind of came organically?
Well, I've been working with I've been thinking a lot about the Hudson River School in general, like with the boys just want to have fun. So the images kind of made its way from one project to the other, but in a different way. So I did have the images beforehand, and I knew that I wanted to create or represent this queer body in a much more kind of amorphous way. And so as I was kind of thinking about that, it was like what I wanted to get out of that wouldn't come through across in paint. So that's when the silicone came about. So I was thinking about the blob as this queer character. And I was thinking about kind of this wonderful kind of squishiness of like the real Phil dildo. So I was thinking about dildos, I was thinking about the blob, I was thinking about how can I make this figure both of those things and interact with these images that I was already thinking about for years. And so yeah, that's kind of somehow how it came about. But it also kind of, things happen in a weird way where I don't know how. Yeah.
Okay, in your Boys Just Want to Have Fun series, I was curious about the clothing. So, because clothing seems really important as a covering of the body and the replication of yourself. So it seems like, how specific did you get on like the color and the type of clothing you were wearing and how that was chosen?
So when I first started that project, it was very specific. I was wearing an outfit. So I had spent about 3 months just going around the country camping and going to all the national parks, and I wore the same outfit for the entire, I mean, I had like six of the same shirts so that I could, you know, be clean, but it was very specific to having, like, not, it wasn't a Boy Scout outfit, but it had all the colors. It was very similar. Like, I wanted to convey the kind of Boy Scout. But then in other areas, when I was working up in Maine, I wanted, like, that red shirt to just really pop off, like, next to that water. So it started out more with the Boy Scouts, but then it started to become more of a visual thing. And then with like the Lake George and the other few ones, I intentionally was like, okay, I'm not gonna wear a shirt because I want it to be much more, I want the scar showing. So there were specific reasons for that. And then a lot of times it's just instinctual. Yeah. Any other questions? Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you, Cobi. I'm not going to try that microphone because it always fails. No, that's fine. I want to thank Cobi for coming and being able to give us that wonderful art talk. That was delightful. And give such wonderful insight into your work. This is also the moment that I get to thank Cuesta College for helping to make this possible. Thank Howard Carroll and the Harold J. Miossi Foundation for endowing the gallery and making it possible for us to support and bring in artists like Cobi Moules. Thank Bo Burnham and Magnolia Stork, the team behind the gallery that helps to make this all possible. We couldn't do this without them. Thank the Fine Arts Division, which helps to support and house the gallery and gives us all these wonderful students to introduce all these wonderful artists to. This show has a couple of extra programming events happening in conjunction with it. We will be showing the blob in the gallery on February 29th at noon and at 5:30, and we will be having a panel discussion after the 5:30 showing where we'll get into some of the gritty details explored in the movie and explored in Cobi's work. We will also be having a wonderful specifically curated and choreographed dance performance by the staff at Slow Movement Arts Center, and that will be happening in direct response to Cobi's work in the gallery on March 14th. So that'll be also at 12 and at 6 p.m. We look forward to seeing you all there, and come out and see the show if you haven't seen it yet. Thank you so much for coming.